Boyko?
How we doing? You know that song.
Yep.
It's about time we got some good music.
That Outkast.
Some good music.
Yeah, it's good music. Good, I'm not going to deny that. This is college
so
music
how
for
you,
me.
How does it feel to be a married man, Boyko?
Ooh, married. Yes, folks, there it is. There is the ring to rule them all.
I don't know about that.
Yep, she's officially a Boyko.
Cursed.
What?
A cursed.
Boyko.
A cursed.
Boyko. Terrible. Yes, she's not cursed. Why is she cursed? What does a cursed mean in that sense then? That a curse has been placed upon her?
Yeah. She's got to carry the grand Boyko name.
Yes. Was the wedding stressful to get ready? Yeah. We had this like elaborate awning with PVC. You saw it. And things hanging.
I did.
And things hanging. Go with the bit.
I did.
And we set up about 20 different centerpieces? No, 10 or 15 different.
The fruit bar. The fruit table.
The fruit table was there. You probably saw it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The tuxes were a little.
It was a beautiful day weather-wise.
The tuxes were a little stressful.
How's a tux stressful?
Because, you know, one of the groomsmen, you know, didn't have shoes. So you got to find shoes. The tents, the morning of the wedding, both tents broke. Like metal bars.
Because it was supposed to rain that day.
And the rain had rained the day before, so these tents are literally, they're peak tents, so the water's sitting on the two sides.
Oh.
And then it just, and of course Emily's like, I'm getting married today. Like, and I'm like, they're going to come fix it, everything's going to be okay. Let's
and then it didn't rain
out
the rest of the day.
No, I guess that was the day before the wedding. Yeah.
It rained Friday, but I think it even rained early Saturday morning.
Saturday morning, did it?
Before the sun came out, I think it rained early. It was supposed to rain again.
So when the tent people came, because we were on that phone.
Yeah, absolutely.
I have to give them credit. They did fix it, and they did fix it fast. No plug, though. No plug.
Intended.
Sorry. You're not getting a plug from
intended
me.
Intended.
None of my 16-year-old students will be buying your stuff.
Intended.
What is that? What? Intendant? Why are you throwing all these words around? Like, I want to act like I'm intelligent. By the way, he put the tie on just for the show. I do want everyone to know that. He put it on just for the show.
There's reasons for that.
What are the reasons?
But we'll discuss.
Oh, correct.
So the wedding, and it they got the tent fixed. And it was a beautiful day. It didn't rain.
It was. We thought it would be raining.
It
would be terrible. I got the first message from Emily 3 weeks before the wedding, and it had like a picture of storms. And she's like, it's going to rain. And I was like, this is 3 weeks away. But when we got about 4 days away.
It was nothing but rain.
It was supposed to still rain. And
it did rain. It rained Friday quite a bit. Saturday was supposed to rain.
You were there. You saw it. Didn't rain.
It was a beautiful day.
Yeah, beautiful day. You saw that.
Not a lick of sunshine. I mean, not a lick of cloud.
I gotta give some thank yous during the ceremony. My friend Paul, his job up north is production. He produces things. Meaning, if you go to a football game, the music at the beginning, all the graphics, you know, the sound effects.
Yeah, yeah.
That's his job. So literally, while I was getting married, he was holding my iPad behind him, running the wedding music. When it was the bridesmaid's turn, he turns on the bridesmaid's music, and no one saw him do it.
That's
and he's
good.
Literally holding
that's a,
my
that's
iPad.
That's a professional.
He knew what he was doing.
That's
shout
a,
out to
that's
Paul.
A, that's a professional.
Spider, yeah, my boy Giancarlos. Let's just say, seeing this very tiny Hispanic guy having to carry a watering can to the water fountain and back is one of my best moments of this wedding because he didn't want to spill it. So he's walking with this watering can. By the way, one of our things was we planted a tree. We both love planting stuff. You saw it. It's a nice tree. And it's a symbol
of our
families.
How about you plant a tree at my house this summer?
I planted plenty of plants at your house, and I'm sure 90% of them are still alive, right?
A good chunk of them are.
Yeah. Yeah, if they died, it was that rain that we got afterwards.
Mm-hmm.
Too much rain.
Too much rain, yeah.
That was like a week of pounding rain last summer.
That was a month of pounding rain.
Well, you know, we only get 4 weeks, so, and if I go on my honeymoon for a week, you only got 3 weeks of slave Boyko, okay?
Yeah, that is true.
3 weeks of you sitting on a porch with iced tea, yep, peach iced tea, pointing and saying, right there, Boyko. No, to the left. Boyko, listen.
Mm-hmm.
I said right there. That's where I was. Yeah, that's called planting for Balkmon.
Would you like a drink?
Do you have another one?
No.
Oh. I've got my green water, and this is the best spot for it.
Oh, whatever.
Just back and forth, blocking your face.
No, it ain't.
Hey, where did Balkmon go?
I don't block my face.
Where did, it does. It's a green screen. It would block your face.
Whatever.
Wait till you see that edit.
So, the wedding went off. The weather was nice. It went off without a hitch.
Everything was perfect.
And then, so now...
Oh, I do have to say, you saw this happen, so you know this happened, but the people watching didn't. While I was reading my vows, first off, my classes asked me, hey, Boyko, are you going to cry at your wedding? And I'm like, no, why? I'm just getting married. She might. I'm like, Emily might. She's emotional. And so here I am. I got seven note cards.
Hey, that's a long
one. I'm organized. No, there was only a few sentences a card.
That's long.
And I'm reading my vows. This is when you make promises to each other.
I never make a promise that I can't keep. That ain't me.
I think Omar just died. Omar, you all right? Omar.
Right here.
Okay.
He all right?
He's okay. No, but I mean,
that's probably the best song he heard all week.
He's got this in his headphones too, and I almost had a stroke just now.
It's just the best music he heard all week.
Maybe the song
Continue
that started.
On. Continue on.
So I'm reading my cards, talking about, you know, meeting her for the first time, all this.
Oh.
Yeah. Yeah. And then I'm like, I thought maybe I would get a little like, you know, during the last card. Because I wrote something really nice.
Oh.
But by card four, I was like.
Emotions make us cry sometimes.
Man, I started to get emotional.
Emotions make us cry sometimes.
The Justice of the Peace pulled one of those things where he's like, here, son. Yeah, here, son. And I was like, oh, my God, is it that bad? Is it that bad? I was mic'd. I was mic'd because they were taking a video of it. So, yeah, and then I made a joke of skipping cards. But I didn't skip them. I just made a joke. And then I got to the last card, and it was tough.
Mm-hmm.
Emily, she must have zoned out. She must have been so emotional to the buildup that when she was standing there, it was just... And she read her vows, and she looked at me, and she said, I do. And I said,
zone.
I do. And I'm zone. Or I should say, I was like, I do, you know?
A zone.
She was in the zone. Zone. She was in the zone.
She probably went to auto zone.
I mean, she might have been on automatic and in the zone, but I don't think she was looking for car parts during her wedding.
No, she was in the zone.
Oh, boy. So then we did our photographs. We had a cool photographer, but we had a drone, folks. What do you see some of this footage? This thing's just hovering around.
To an extreme.
No, but I mean, you know, when your movie star's getting married, this is the way it is. Look, YouTube stars have elaborate weddings. Our 19 people who watch this.
Okay, that makes sense.
I'll
give you that.
That's our crowd.
I'll give you that. All
or right. 17 after the last joke you made, but.
I'll give you that.
I got to give a shout out to Isaac and Antonio, my magicians. Dude, they killed it. They killed it. They had people laughing, slapping the table at the wedding, like wondering where the cards went.
Wondering.
That was actually.
What I'm going to do.
Okay, you should have stopped after the first line because then you hit these notes that you can't hit. Do you sing in the church choir?
Everybody sings, Boyko.
Yeah, but I mean, when I went to church, this is how I sang.
Everybody sings. Music is the language of the world.
Hallelujah.
Isn't that right, Omar?
Hallelujah.
Music is the language of the world.
You want me to put a globe up?
That would make sense. Because it is the language of the world. And this is a global school. International studies.
International study school. More about that next year. Yes, we did this dance. It was pretty cool. I came out with my guitar. Emily came out with like a fan, and I played this guitar thing about 20 seconds and then threw my guitar to my brother, and then we did a beautifully choreographed waltz. So
you were back in Germany.
No, not that kind of waltz. Not that kind of waltz.
Oh, Austria.
Austria, maybe more Austrian waltz.
Oh,
yeah.
Yes.
Let's stick to Austria on this one. You know, it's only been 2 weeks since I've married. Maybe we can keep it out of the Nazi jokes, by the way. She is German. Got the German blood.
That's always
got
to be
It's
one.
Official. It's My always, children will have German
it's
blood.
It's always got to be a flaw somewhere.
So, yeah, it's weird, you know. There was only one black person there. Can you believe that? Mm-hmm. You would think that I guess just because I didn't have a lot of friends.
No surprise.
But do you know who the one black person there was?
Mm-mm.
The DJ. The DJ, DJ Balkmon. You didn't know this was coming.
Hey, Mr. How, DJ.
How did you miss my wedding?
I couldn't get across Dr. King.
If you've been waiting for that
I couldn't
line.
I couldn't get across Dr. King Drive.
Dr. King
Drive was the dividing
there was,
point.
There was construction?
Dr. King Drive. And once me and my wife got into the black neighborhood, it's like the car would not cross Dr. King Drive.
You missed my wedding. The one person that we discussed last week from school. The one person that, yes, we've joked about that is African American. Mm-hmm. Not that that's a big deal.
Mm. Yeah.
But you and I have been friends for a few years.
Okay.
You missed my wedding.
I told you what happened.
That is a terrible excuse.
Not it.
Folks, you know why he didn't find my wedding?
I went to the wrong park.
Because he was stupid.
I went to the wrong park.
He forgot the invitation. One.
I didn't forget it.
For some reason, they couldn't use their cell phone to search. Two.
No, we did. We did. But the park that you was at said closed. And so we were like, well, that can't be the place because it's closed. Never did it dawn on us it was closed because you have reserved the park. You can buzz all you want to, but it was a beautiful day. And I learned a lot about Tarpon Springs
I'm debating right now whether we're friends.
I learned a lot about Tarpon Springs when I was there, when we was there.
The only thing, according to you, you learned is there are actually black people in Tarpon.
That was number one. That was a shocker. That was a shocker. I didn't know they had a Dr. King Drive in Tarpon Springs. So that's one thing we found. And my wife was like, there ain't no black people living here. I said, it got to be. There's a Dr. King here. She said, no, ain't no black people in Tarpon Springs. And I said, it got to be. Look, that's the city bus. And no sooner had we saw the city bus, we saw nothing but black people walking up and down the street. Because all of a sudden, all the churches popped up. The First Baptist Church.
You're in Tarpon Springs. It's all churches. Greek Orthodox.
They didn't want no Greek Orthodox.
Oh, no, it was Baptist on MLK.
Yeah.
It's okay. I'm saying you said there's no churches.
Macedonian Baptist Church. You
there
know,
are churches. There was a Macedonian Baptist? That's interesting.
You know, that. Then you know it's black when you see that Macedonian.
No, Macedonia is Alexander the Great.
Have you ever been to a white church named Macedonia?
I've never been to a white church with anything in the front other than church.
But they'll have like,
hey, it's church.
It'll say United Methodist Church.
Yes.
Or
yes.
When you
but Macedonia is one of the whitest places in Europe.
And that's where, and you'll find.
Sort of whitest.
And you'll find every black neighborhood will have a Macedonian.
That's interesting. Why Macedonian? Tell me the history behind that. I want to learn something here.
I don't know. I just see it. That's how I know we're in a
but
black neighborhood.
But it's a black church. Macedonian. Yeah. Uh-huh. Interesting. I'm going to look that up.
Yeah, look it up, Boyko.
All right.
Look it up.
Well,
since we
by the way,
about
last
life.
Week, no, wait, before you move on, oh, we're coming back to the city bus.
Oh, come back to the
so, city bus. So, last week you said that someone who couldn't go to the wedding sent something in their stead for not going. So, you missed the wedding. What is it now I expect?
A gift.
My gift! I expect my gift.
And you're going to get one.
There's only one person that I'm going to demand a gift from because you said, why don't you invite everybody? Invite them all.
And you know who wanted to give you a gift?
Probably your wife,
not
you.
That's right.
You would have been like, we didn't eat nothing. We didn't eat the food at the wedding. We ain't giving him nothing.
We didn't.
That's because you missed it.
Yeah, we ended up stopping at the ABC Pizza.
You gave up chicken Marseille.
But I did have the chicken dinner at the ABC Pizza.
The pizza place was a chicken dinner?
And it was good, too.
Fried chicken?
No.
It was a real chicken dinner?
Yeah.
Parmesan?
No, lemon chicken.
I was going to be like, they make a fried chicken.
It was good.
All right.
And rice? Man, that was some good stuff. You know, making me, as I think about it, I might get that tomorrow. After work.
Same place? There's another ABC nearby?
Yes. You know, remember what we got the flowers from?
Wait, got flowers?
On Hillsborough, when we went and got the plants on Hillsborough last summer.
Yeah.
And ABC Pizza is like a couple of blocks up the street.
Oh, okay. I know where it's at.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I know where it's at. Well, I had the time of my life. I absolutely loved my wife. And back to your city bus comment, we're going to cut here because the school had a very special visitor
today. Big day.
Hence why he's in a tie. The only reason Balkmon would wear a tie is if it was for who?
For me.
Lies. Ungawa.
Oh, no. But it is a big day.
Why?
It is a big day. This is one of the biggest days of the year for Jefferson High School.
It's definitely a big day for civil rights in Jefferson.
And the news was out here. Even them...
For a good reason.
And even them people we don't like to talk about, even they decided to show up.
Downtown.
Even they showed up.
The real ties.
Yeah.
Did our old boy come back? No. He had to have.
No, I didn't see him. Sucker.
Didn't come back. Sucker. What are you now? You Mr. T? Pity the fool.
I pity him because he missed out on a glorious day.
He probably did.
He missed out on a glorious day.
It's a very beautiful day, and here is this green and yellow bus of Montgomery.
It was
Montgomery, Alabama.
It was fascinating.
Intro: what we're about to see.
A replica. It's not the original bus Rosa Parks was on, but it was a time era bus that Rosa Parks was on.
So it would have looked just like this.
So this
it's just not the bus.
It's not the bus, but it looks like
the bus.
It is a bus model. It's just not the bus.
Yeah.
Rosa Parks was on because that's in a museum. But this is what the bus looked like. The model of the bus, the inside of the bus. This is what.
And can you introduce the civil rights leader that was on it?
What civil rights leader?
That guy was a civil rights leader, wasn't he?
Oh, the one talking to the fourth period class?
Yeah. Did he leave?
Yeah, he left fourth period at the fifth period after they had lunch.
All right, well.
Clarence Fort.
And he was, I'm told, one of the first organizers of a protest here in Tampa?
Yeah, and those who live in East Tampa know there's a park off, what street is that? Osborne and 29th. And there's a park right there that's named after him.
No kidding.
Yeah.
So we had a guy who has a park named after him on campus today.
That's right.
Pretty cool.
Mm-hmm. All right. And that former leader of ours would miss an opportunity like this.
All right, folks, let's show it to you. Here we go.
Has anybody still have the movie? Does anybody still have the movie? Right? Watch the movie, because there's a scene where she's singing. I forgot what the song is. And she's talking to kids, students on the bus, which is a segregated bus. You will see this bus. This bus is part of that.
Okay. Am I set?
Yes.
If this were the replica of the bus, which it is, then, how exactly do they make
Mischief Washington, and the course that I teach is African American history, and I also teach a digital course which is African American history infused with civil rights with Miss Aguil Rosa in Rochester, New York at School Without Walls. Today, as you saw, we have a very special guest here, which is a replica of the Rosa Parks bus and owned by Mr. Van Hemkewijk, and he's allowing us to tour that bus and make what we've been learning in the classroom real. I have with me Saba Baptiste. We were part of the African American History Task Force last year, and again, she heard about this great opportunity and is just here to share her support. So we welcome her and we're glad to have her.
Thank you. This is like a historical moment, just to think that people are reinventing history.
Absolutely.
And students are going to be able to walk through this process. So, I mean, for me, I'm learning, because we all learn every time we have a new experience. And just to think they traveled from New York, Rochester, to give us this experience is great. Thank you.
It's interesting when you're on the bus, where you see white Yes.
And then you see color.
Yes. Because again, we read about it.
Yeah.
But to see it.
To see it.
And to really understand, hopefully understand that
see,
that's the way.
They on the bus all wrong.
Okay. Yeah.
See, if they were to be authentic, you know, the white one should be up front.
Yes.
And the black one should be in the back.
That's it.
Yeah, it's flipped.
Yeah, it's flipped.
But you
the whites have migrated to the back. And the
I think another interesting fact was where Rosa Parks actually sat.
Yeah, no man's land.
No man's land. And so many of us did not know that Rosa Parks really, she didn't sit in front at the time of arrest, even though we saw photos of that. But what Mr. White did a great job of also explaining today, that was a picture taken following her arrest. So that she decided to get back on the bus after integration to show
she now
things have changed. But we have been embedded in our minds to believe that she was in the front. But in fact, she's not.
Do I have this story right? Which is, she was sitting where she was supposed to. It's just the white section had filled up.
Yes.
And then they asked her to move an additional seat.
Yes. Absolutely.
Yes.
Back.
She needed to move back.
Like, I'm where I'm supposed to be. I'm not going to move.
That's the no man's land. She was okay, but it was... As you see when you get on there, Boyko, the bus is really small.
It is.
So you can see it wouldn't take long to fill up.
I noticed about that bus?
It's green.
It was green. It was kind of small.
Very small. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. And
you can see why.
Very not. They had to have filled that bus up really fast with people.
Mm-hmm.
So to clarify, and I'm not sure whether it made the video or not, she was where she was supposed to be.
She could sit in that area, but if more whites came on the bus. And she would have had to move.
And it looks like that bus filled up quick sometimes.
Yeah, it would have took long.
So the bus driver comes back and says, I'm sorry, ma'am, you need to move one closer to the front.
You need to move to the back.
Oh, yeah, to the back. Mm-hmm. And she said, I'm where I'm supposed to be. I'm not going to move.
Or she was like, no. And why you pick on us? That's what
she chose the perfect time to make a stance. Mm-hmm.
And she did go to jail for it. But they were not intending... for what happened to happen on that day. It just, well, you know what? It is what it is, and maybe it's time for us to move on it. But that wasn't the first time she had been arrested for not getting out of her seat.
She was a rebel from the beginning.
They were hoping for someone else. They were grooming somebody else.
Oh, to do this
to do
type
what
of
she
thing?
Did. Something happened, and they couldn't use that person, and this happened, and they were like, you know what, maybe this is... Let's do it now. Let's do it now.
So this was kind of a setup. Kind of a setup. I'm going to sit here. I know they're going to tell me to move, and now I'm not going to move. So she knew what was going to happen.
Yeah, I'm sure she knew what was going to happen. I mean, it was no...
And unfortunately, she died just last year, didn't she?
No.
Yeah, it's only a few years,
yeah,
tops.
Yeah, maybe...
Two.
No. She's been dead for a while.
Really?
Yeah.
I could have sworn it was very recent.
I mean, as far as how long life is recent, but I think President Bush was still, he was still the president when she died.
That's over 8 years.
Yeah, over 8 years ago. I think she died in like, let me see, Coretta Scott King died in what, 06?
That's MLK's wife?
Yeah, MLK's wife died in 06. I think Rosa Parks died around that same time.
I think I am going to tell my story, Balkmon. You know how we discussed whether I would tell it or not?
Which one? You have so many stories.
The daughter of Martin Luther King.
Oh, you want to tell it now?
Here's my story.
Here's your story.
I'm in college, probably my second or third year. And the group of people I'm running with at the time are a basketball, well, sort of running with, one of my sports teams that I'm playing intramurals with is an all-black team called the MOB. These kids were from Orlando. I still don't know what the acronym means, by the way. They never told me. It's because I'm white. So, I was at practice with them, and I had my hair in cornrows, which I used to love, and I still love having my hair in cornrows. And we're going to discuss
anytime
that.
Anytime you play basketball.
You and I are going to discuss that topic on a different day, because that came up recently in social issues.
Anytime you play basketball, you like
Yeah. Since I was playing basketball, I like my hair up and tight. And the same with soccer. Weirdly, I when I played soccer with the Caribbean Culture Exchange, I was the only white kid on that team, too. I had my hair in cornrows because it stayed where it was supposed to be. So here I am coming home from the gym. I'm in basketball shorts and what white people call a wife beater, which is that white rib tank top. So cornrows.
I think everybody knows that.
White rib tank top, basketball shorts. Well, a very well-known dean at the school stopped me, African American, and he says, "Hey, Patrick, you got to come with me." And I was like, "Okay, where? Where are we going?" He's like, "You know, Aunt Martin Luther King Jr.'s daughter is speaking here at USF in the Marshall Hall." And I was like, "I can't go like this. There's no way I can enter that lecture dressed the way I am. That would, first off, it would be disrespectful."
And smelly too.
I didn't really stink, but fine, I'll let you have that. And he's like, "No." And we literally probably
Lysol.
We debated for about 5 minutes. I'm like, I'm like, "You know how I'm going to be viewed if I enter this lecture," which probably had very few white people.
No surprise.
I'm just being honest.
I know.
And very
rude
prominent.
And disrespectful.
Very prominent African Americans from all over Tampa. So somehow, and I have to be honest, I'm not sure how he did it, and I don't know if I would have done it in the past, today, but he did somehow convince me to attend this lecture the way I was to see her speak. Now, I would have never even thought about it, because I love lectures, if I had been dressed appropriately. So here's the thing. I walk in. Since he's a prominent African American at USF, he gets special permission. So guess where I was going to sit?
You were going to sit up front.
I was in the front row.
Front row.
So I have to tell you, from the trip from the door to sitting down, I, as a white male, for the first time, probably had an inkling. I'm not going to say I knew what it felt like, because that's not fair. But I had an inkling of what it might feel like to be judged based on how I look and the color of my skin. How would you have judged me? Here comes this college white boy.
Disrespectful.
Right?
Disrespectful.
And I totally wasn't.
Rude and disrespectful behavior.
And I'm walking in with the dean that kicks you out of school.
And got the nerve to want to sit in the front.
Exactly. How dare he?
I couldn't do that if it was some white person that was speaking. They like, "What you doing here?" They'd have sit.
So
they'd have said, "Go." They'd have said, "Go to the showers, clean yourself up, and maybe we might let your tail in here when you come back."
So still to this day, I'm thankful that he made me do that. And still to this day, as hard as it was, I think it is an amazing perspective that I don't think a lot of us get to have. I think you can have it explained to you. I think you can go see a bus and say, "This is where you sat, this is where we sat." That's not good enough.
Like, we were on the bus.
Yeah, like you guys saw us. Me and my section, Balkmon and his. I that was the first time where I really, as a college student, and that's why sometimes, you know, we're kind of hard on our high school students, but, you know, sometimes it takes a little while. That was the first time I really felt like, oh, okay. This wasn't fair. It wasn't fair. I didn't deserve that. But it happens daily in our country.
Daily.
The opposite way. Daily.
Hourly.
And I can't imagine walking in my neighborhood and feeling how I felt that day, every day.
Hourly.
I can't imagine. So it put me in a perspective that I've never had. And I wanted to tell you that story because it's a crazy story. And guess what he made me do at the end of the lecture?
You got to go speak to her.
I had to go introduce myself and shake her hand. And I know that she looked at me and said, "Who the F is this? He must be in trouble. This kid must be, he must have done something on campus that got him in trouble.
He needs guidance. He's a troubled white youth."
By the way, so now let me talk about the lecture, because this is all great. She did just what MLK used to do. She starts out very quiet, very preacher, and delivers this speech. And by the end of it, she is just powering away with these lines, and you just feel the power in the room growing. And that was Bernice King. That was Bernice King.
Yeah, she's...
I've been lucky. I've met some amazing people in my life.
I think you have one.
You're not one of them, but I have met some amazing people in my life.
I think they had four
kids, two girls, two boys.
Yeah, two and two.
What are the boys up to? You said his other daughter died, unfortunately.
Yeah, she died a few years ago.
What are the sons doing? They following footsteps or no? No.
The third is, I don't know what Dexter's doing. I thought Dexter wanted to start was trying to do Hollywood for a while. I know they've struggled over the last few years.
As a family, or
yeah, the legacy, trying to figure out
what's a very big shadow.
But what to do with the legacy?
Well, I know we discussed the fact that they don't allow you to use his words.
Yeah, they copyrighted
for safety reasons. And you've explained it to me. I agree. You have to be careful how his words may be used.
I did not know they're having an issue with we shall overcome.
Really?
It's been copyrighted. It was copyrighted. So you just can't use the song.
You can't put it down.
Yeah, without permission. So they're going to court over it. And one of the reasons they copyrighted it was that Pete Siegel. He copyrighted it, and he said the only reason he did it, he didn't want Hollywood to get it.
Well, I could see you don't want that. You know, normal music bands like the Beatles, their music gets thrown around and put on commercials. Mm-hmm. Like take the Revolution song. Nike used it to make it look like we're changing shoes.
Mm-hmm.
I can see why the King family doesn't want this to be used incorrectly, and then We Shall Overcome is on like a Publix commercial. You know what I mean? And it's like, okay, that's you've definitely taken the power out.
Or definitely you're using it in the context that his words or the song was never.
You're taking power away from what it was.
Yeah. So I think they've more, over the last few years, they've more struggled on what to do with the legacy.
Well, they themselves are now getting older too. So who's it going to be left to after the 50, after the 75?
Because I think
years?
The only one who has a child is Dexter. I don't think the others have children. Bernice may have them. I can't remember. It seemed like they only recently had
a first grandchild.
Yeah,
type.
You know they're gone now, but their first grandchild I think only came recently. So they haven't really been, you know how certain family lines, you're like, really, that family line doesn't exist? Theirs is one of those that, you know.
You're surprised that there's not kids keeping it going.
That they didn't have more children.
Yeah, because you hear about the Kennedys all the time.
Because there's so many of them.
Good Lord.
But you know, like Lincoln, the Lincoln family line ended years ago. But you would have thought the Lincoln would still be around. The Lincoln line would keep going, but as time wore by.
And there's a new family line coming.
Obama.
Boyko. The Boyko family line.
Oh, Lord have mercy.
Stay tuned.
So sad.
Stay tuned. She officially, guys, changed her name this morning. My wife is now officially Emily Boyko.
She took on the curse, Omar. She took on the curse. At least she's embracing it. Boyko, let me ask you this question.
I did it. I tricked a female into marrying me.
You definitely did that. Let me ask you this question, Wick. I don't know where that came from.
The question or that terrible yawn?
The terrible yawn.
All right. Ask your question. Or is the yawn still putting you, punching you in
Here's
your head
question,
at the moment?
Here's the question, Boyko. I was reading something the other day.
You can read?
And it was talking about and this is right up your alley. That by and large, people in society are very good at taking care of their close acquaintances, family, close friends. They're very good at taking care of their external relationships, Facebook, Twitter. But the middle relationships, where we have to deal with, they're not doing very well with.
Is this along the lines of that one Einstein quote where he's like, you're all going to be sitting next to each other, but no one will be talking and you'll be looking down?
No, but it's the idea that you have this middle group, like associations. So
let me try and clarify. My family, we're all very close and talk.
We do good with them.
And we protect them. My Facebook, I constantly check, and I'm keeping an eye on people.
Yeah, they're good.
And I'm happy birthdaying, which drives me nuts. But coworkers
or associations, like the PTSA associations.
So community.
Community. There we go. Community.
So our bubble's really small.
Our community relationships are bad.
So I have a closer connection to my German friend in Germany than I do to my local...
Your community.
Boys and Girls Club type thing. That's interesting.
And because of that, that's why... And the article was in relation to politics. Why the politics have become so nasty is because I don't have to deal with community. I don't have to learn how to deal with someone who has a different view of things.
Because I don't talk to anyone.
I don't have to talk. Only talk to people I really want to talk to.
Do you think this election has forced people? Because, I mean, let's be honest.
I think it's forced.
If you're a person who, no offense, is voting for Trump, you might not tell anyone due to the stigma attached.
I disagree. I think you tell people.
Some don't. I think this.
Or it's come to the point, if you don't agree with my view, I don't even have to deal with you.
We're not even going
to
talk. Yeah.
So
there's no discussion.
So you don't learn how to bridge differences with that middle group.
Which makes you attack each other versus discuss.
Mm-hmm.
It's possible. Do you think this is just an unavoidable
thing? Think about what you talked about with your class here recently. And Jefferson as the community.
And it took me, I guess, tricking them. It was a trick.
It sure was.
It was a trick. I'll put the question I put on the board up first.
No.
You don't think I should do that?
No, we do. Well, we don't want you to. I don't want you to have happen what happened to.
All right, so we won't put the question I asked up. Oh, her?
Yeah.
You're gonna compare me to her? The one who said take a survey?
Yeah.
You're gonna compare me to survey teacher? No, that wasn't. That's not up there with survey teacher.
But I would say this. Kids, but think about it. Our kids, they're very good at their personal relationships. The people at the table that they eat lunch with.
Okay.
But when we say community, even though they're in the building together.
Do you think they think of community as their phone before they do the
neighborhood? Yeah, I think so. They don't see school as a community that we're invested in.
So this is just a place you come, waste 7 hours, and then you get to go do what you want to do.
Mm-hmm.
Or you mix in what you want to do while you're at school, which is connect to those in your community.
Mm-hmm.
And one person could be.
Or maybe our view of community. Okay, so you think about it. If you have a Facebook page, you can group with like people and ignore people who don't like what you like.
Yeah, and I have to be honest that Emily and I, due to certain things posted recently,
but
you befriend people because you're like, well, I don't really want to see this crap anymore.
So as time goes by, if someone doesn't like what you like,
you're not friends.
Nor do I need to deal with you.
Except work.
And even then,
the work's weird. We have to deal with each other at work.
Do you
think we rebel? I think most jobs, you know, Emily's job's very close working. Ours can be with PLCs and stuff, you know.
You know, they often say high school is nothing but independent contractors.
I mean, yeah, you're not coming in my room to check what I'm doing. You just look at the finished product, and if it's acceptable, you passed. And I mean teachers.
And think about it.
Contracts.
How many? All right.
Interesting.
The teacher next to you, in the room next door to you. How often she deals with you on a teacher basis?
Okay.
Because you don't teach the same things.
No.
So what would...
It's high and buy.
If it's not called into a, if we're not called into a department meeting.
Yeah, I mean, other than when we used to sit at lunch.
But I mean, the thing is, she teaches classes you have, you don't, we interact only because we both teach the same class. So that makes us interact a little more.
But if then they made it mandatory.
Yeah. And then they made it mandatory. If they didn't make it mandatory.
Maybe not as often.
Mm-hmm.
Or it would just be like we used to, which was what we consider our in passing. Mm-hmm. We used to just have we had PLCs, we just didn't call them PLCs. Yeah. It was, Boyko, let's talk.
Yeah.
Where are you at?
Do I go next door and see what? No, because you don't teach the same thing I do.
Yeah, yeah.
So
independent contractors.
We're all independent contractors, which is probably one of the reasons why it's hard for high schools to build community. Because we
everyone's so different.
You visit your world where rules are your rules. You visit my world where my rules are my rules. Where you can't say certain words.
And then when the administration tries to get everybody to be uniform,
yeah, it's tough.
It's tough because you can't tell me what to do in my room. But my idea is that the idea of that the community thing we struggle with so badly, it now is affecting the way people communicate and deal with one another.
In small, forced environments. And I'm going to go further on this. I want to ask you this because it's do you think that that a lot has to do with this because of the number of people that are leaving church? Because church used to be that community.
That's an interesting question.
So there is an exodus away from religion at the moment. The community changes. Where would I go to meet people now?
Well, that is true. I would never thought about
church.
That.
I don't want to make sound like church is forced because it's not. A lot of people do go for the community aspect.
But it would be the community.
But that would be you all go to bat for each other.
The community activity. Well, think on it made me think on this. When I grew up, I knew everybody on the street.
Gangster.
I know you lived on 10 acres of land.
Yeah. And I don't have a cow sound. So, hold on, let's see.
So that's why you knew everybody. Why you knew everybody on your street. But
hey, Mr. Smith. No, I lived out in the middle of nowhere.
I know, that's why.
I didn't know anyone on my street because we all lived miles from each other.
So, but I think about it. I don't even speak to my neighbors. I don't know their names.
I wave at mine. I know Ruby. She's a very affluent African-American in Tampa. She sets up the Martin Luther King stuff.
I just, I waved to my neighbor next door. He's got a dog, But I don't...
You don't know his name?
I don't know his name.
Yeah.
We're not trying to hold a conversation.
Why do you think we did that? Why is it easier for me to ignore my neighbor?
Is it, as the article said, just again, get your thought, that we... as a society are now more into self instead of self-sacrifice.
Oh, 100%. I think
self-indulgence.
I think technology has, of course, forced self-indulgence in front of everything. Why would I watch my wife's TV show when I can be in my area, she can watch hers, and I can watch mine? So now we're away from each other. So you have to force yourself in the evenings, and this can be anyone.
Yeah, it's true because years ago there was only one TV.
Decide on a TV show and watch it together, or read the same book at the same time, so that you can discuss it. Otherwise, you're playing Candy Crush and I'm playing video games, and we don't talk to each other about what we were just doing. Or the news. Sometimes you discuss the news, but I don't think these are normal.
People rarely watch the news they did. 20,
well, it, like you said, ago. It was the only thing on TV at 7 p.m. See. Everyone sat down and it's like, oh, it's the news. Plus the news has gotten, local news has gotten very just, ugh. Sorry, Channel 10, 13,
this is the CBS Evening News.
Yeah, you're... 60 reporting. Minutes.
Reporting, Walter Cronkite.
This is Walter Cronkite, and we're landing on the moon. That's not the best.
This is NBC Nightly News. With Tom Brokaw.
Tom Brokaw, that's right.
Good evening.
Who's the guy that did the Olympics, 76 Olympics, where he became famous because of the assassinations? What was that guy's name? He recently retired like 10 years ago. Dan Rather? Is that Dan Rather was a big guy? I don't think that was Dan Rather, though.
No, I'm with Dan Rather.
All these names that you guys don't know, we had relationships with, meaning every night we would sit and trust this person on the TV.
You were used to them. Everybody watched the same.
Barbara Walters.
Yeah, Barbara Walters. Peter Jennings.
That's who it was. It was Peter Jennings that became famous because of the 76 Olympics.
And he died from cancer 10 years ago. That's what you're thinking. He died of cancer.
Really? He died? Yeah. I thought he retired.
No, he died of cancer.
Good Lord.
He died of cancer.
Boo cancer.
Yeah, he died of cancer.
Boo cancer.
Yeah, I mean, I think it was interesting because we're talking about how do we...
Well, think of virtual school. I mean, why can't you and I
talked about that,
why can't you and I teach thousands of people in front of this screen and in front of that camera? Why do we have to teach in front of 20 that at the moment might not want to be there? You know, sometimes you're tired, sometimes you're on the ball.
Sometimes you got stuff on.
You're requiring 25 or more or less people to all be on the ball at the same time
which is hard.
It is hard. I mean, this is why teaching is such a challenge.
Because people bring all kind of issues.
Yeah, look at sixth period, although you're fifth, right, Omar? Fifth. Think of how many different personalities are in that class.
At different
points. And you've seen it. You've seen it succeed, and you've seen it fail.
At different points in life. I think sometimes we give the impression all the kids are at the same point in life.
Maturity slash.
And they're not. They're all over the place. And you're trying to get all those in a room.
Same with teachers. I'm of course way more mature than Balkmon, and he's older than me. That's just that's how it is.
Whatever. Whatever. You know what I mean? It makes you think though. Because
So introduce virtual reality into this.
I don't know.
It's over. We don't need to talk to each other ever again in person. I can put my little goggles on, and I can go to any place I want, talk to anyone I want. Maybe there'll be a program.
Who has the same likes as me.
That I can talk to MLK.
And so if you don't have those likes.
I don't need you.
I don't need you, nor do I need to figure out how to bridge the difference to make it work.
No more discussions. No more discussion.
So when you don't see it my way, instead of, okay, let's figure out how we can make this work, you just argue, fuss, and fight.
So let's take it back to the initial argument. Politics today. Is this why it has become more of an attack discussion?
Well, think about it. All right. And I'm just putting this out there. What incentive do the Democrats have in working with the Republicans?
At the moment, none because of the last 8 years. The gridlock that they've both created upon each other.
What incentive do the Republicans have working with the Democrats?
Same answer.
So if a Republican tries to work with a Democrat, what's going to be the consequence?
You might be disowned by said team or both teams.
So there is no incentive for a Republican or a Democrat to work with each other.
True, and if you want to be successful, you must be a extremist of one group or the other, so
is it that community that, hey, we want you to be exclusively conservative, we want you to be exclusively liberal,
and you can't stray
on any topic, even though more than likely the conservative is not always wrong and the liberal is not always right, so thus you get what we have, which is
a giant divide, and not a lot gets done.
But not addressing the issues of the day.
No, it's just arguing over my point is correct. No, my point is correct.
I make you think.
And you know what? We're not going to talk anymore.
And you know what we need to do on one of these shows before we go on vacation? But I know.
Not invite you. Solo.
But we're going to have to get the... you have to beep this word out, Boyko, in the edit.
Okay.
One of them cowardly administrators to come down here, and we need to discuss globalization.
Okay. And do you know, technically, it should be Basham, because she's in charge of the magnet program.
Well, then we need to bring her down here, and we need to discuss globalization, how school are helping our students in a globalized world. Because a lot of this issues why... Trump and Sanders
are so appealing to people is because globalization has hurt the most vulnerable people of the economy. And yet the sides can't figure out how to help the vulnerable.
Without convincing them to go extreme.
Yeah.
More extreme. I don't want it to sound like those guys are super extreme.
You can
extreme,
only tell people, think about it, and Omar might learn this one day. Omar's a 50-year-old man. Globalization has cut his job. Is Omar interested in more school training? At 50?
No. Although 50 might be the new 20, but...
At 50. More than likely, he's like, do I really want to go back to school?
You don't have to go anywhere by that time. You just turn on your phone. But I agree. You're not going to want to learn something new.
And then when he tries to go get a job, that puts him maybe 52, 53.
He's calling you really lazy, Omar.
No, I'm saying...
Took you 3 years to get off your butt, bro.
No, but I mean, if you really want to be trained effectively...
Yeah, a few years. It'll take him to 53.
To 53. Yeah. And if somebody who's younger than him...
Hire him right away. Less money.
And the person interviewing him might be younger than him.
Way younger.
So would that person even want to invest the time in a 53-year-old person? Because they figure in a few years they're going to be pulling for Social Security.
And this is why I think in the future people like Bernie Sanders will be normal, not extreme.
We talked about that in class, that Bernie Sanders in Europe would be mainstream.
Dead center.
And America, because of how our system has developed, he's viewed as way to the
edge. I explained it to my students because my generation, our generation is Generation X. I catch the end of it. Generation X grew up with parents during the Cold War. So my grandparents hated communism so much to the point that the word socialism was attached to it.
That's what we talked about in class today. Socialism was always connected with communism.
Which they're not. Similar.
But most Western European countries are social democratic.
Yeah. You can go the other route with socialism. Mm-hmm. But so my generation was still raised by people that hated communism.
Yeah, communism and socialism.
So once the wall came down in 89 and then the Soviet Union fell in 91, we stopped being scared of it, but I was already through school almost.
But you still associated socialism with communism. The American government could never sell what they was doing to help Western Europe to set up social democratic countries because the word social would have ended the Marshall Plan. But you think about it.
We would have never funded it. It would have been shot.
Like, although you funded down. Communism. That's why they didn't use the term. But that's what they created, a social, and that's why Europe is struggling. Because all these migrants are coming in, putting stress on their social welfare system.
Correct.
But they are democracies through and through.
And so you get to vote to deal with said problem. And that's why countries like Greece have Nazis. 16 people sit in the Greek parliament.
We're showing that in class.
That are openly Nazi.
Look at Denmark. Denmark is probably as open as they are. And they are like, we are not taking anything.
Sweden was the first. I think Switzerland did it, but everyone's just like, oh, Switzerland, they always keep their borders. But Sweden just recently literally said, no immigrants. Mm-hmm. We're not taking anyone else. It's too rough right now. And they've had protests and stuff.
Because you put pressure on the social welfare system. And what I was telling the kids was Bernie Sanders in Europe would be in the middle. Mm-hmm. He'd be normal.
Well, Canada's just like, hey, USA,
The United States has a unique...
Pay attention.
You know, it's like China. If you go to China, the Chinese will always tell you, we are communist with Chinese characteristics.
Which isn't communism, because there's billionaires. There's billionaires.
They're very much capitalist.
They have that structure of the, like, Politburo.
Yeah, but it has the market economy going for it, right? America has its own form that's unique to America, but... America could never transport it over to Europe or Canada. It won't work.
No, because we have too many of those large private companies, like the car companies.
Like
airlines.
Like even education. When Bernie Sanders say, hey, free education for everyone.
Everyone. College.
My own students said no.
Yeah, because I think they know that if you're a student already going to college.
They were like, that's a
no-brainer. You just made me
right
now I have to get a master's.
That's a no-brainer.
I have to
like,
get a master's now.
And my argument is, but if you was in other parts of Europe, they don't have as much as their population going to college.
Yeah, because they sift.
They sift them out
much sooner. Yeah.
But they put them on a track like, look, you're not going to college.
But let me teach you how to make this car part.
And we're gonna teach you and get you ready so when you leave. Yeah. You can get a good job and be able to pay into the social welfare system. Whereas America, we say, we want you to go to college, but college tuition is rising. People are getting in debt. And then when they get out of college,
they have no jobs.
Or if they get a job, the job immediately sends them to school because they want to teach them how they want them to do it. So they can't save money.
Compounding debt. They're never saving money because the second you graduate, you have to start paying college loans. I think you got, 6 months? Yeah,
you have to, within 6 months, start paying.
Which is not long.
Yeah, 6 months, you know, come on.
Especially when you're hunting for a job.
You know, people have $60,000, $70,000, $80,000, $100,000 of debts.
Did you know there's a doctor shortage for this reason?
Yes.
Literally will have issues finding doctors in the next 20 years.
Because the debt is just too pressing.
That and malpractice insurance on top of it. Doctors make very little money now. I don't know if we knew that.
At least when they're getting started. They don't make a lot of money.
You have to work at a hospital.
Yeah, yeah.
So you're safe through them.
You're protected.
Yeah, it's weird. It's weird.
So what happens is, I was telling them, if you lived in Europe, a 19, 20-year-old can, like in Germany, they can get trained, they can get a job, and they walking out the door, $45,000, $50,000 job a year. They're at home. They're going to save money.
And they're paying taxes through that money.
And so they're going to be much further ahead in the game than an American youth.
And they're already giving back to society. It would be a tough road for us,
and now you can see why young people...
Yeah, it's millennials voting
like
for Bernie Sanders.
Yeah. But they're scared because, man, I'm under all this debt, and what do I have to show for it? But America's system is so set up, if you said free tuition for everybody, man, it would break our college. It would break our university systems. What? Think about it. Most colleges depend on universities. Boy, that made no sense. Most universities depend on students to pay for their programs, especially their athletic programs.
Yeah, the tuition is self-funding.
Helps fund their athletic
Athletics
programs.
Is included in everyone's tuition. It's a fee.
And a lot of athletic programs lose money. So if now...
It's because they suck. Oh. Sorry. But not Villanova, folks.
From downtown. Bang! Championship!
Hey, shout out to Bryn Mawr, where I was born. Bryn Mawr, Pennsylvania.
Shout out to Caesar. He was different.
Shout out to Caesar. Was sad. Him and his
But
Tar
I think that's just interesting. That they're seeing... He would be in Europe, be center, and here he's seen as extreme. But because people have not dealt with globalization, politicians haven't dealt with globalization.
But do you also
think people are moving in their direction because at least they're offering a solution they think will work.
Do you also think it's because we're not under the parliamentary system, which is percentage-based voting? Remember, we only have
the two parties, keep in mind, the parliamentary system is in Britain too. But basically, they only have the two-party system.
But they have lots of coalitions.
But typically, one wins the day.
Well, and I think you say there's only two parties, but...
I mean, they have other little parties.
The little parties have been teamed up to create these bigger parties.
The conservatives rule. I shouldn't say rule in the... But
they're
an
advantage.
They have the majority in Britain.
Yeah, which is why we teach in the 1920s the Labour Party gets bigger than the Conservative Party.
But conservatives they won the last two. Labor won the last few. But typically, they're not in a coalition. Very rarely do they have.
But look at Great Britain's movement right now. They want to leave Europe. The Brexit. They're pushing to vote out of Europe.
It's going to be a neck and neck vote.
Which is very scary because the only way Europe works is if the big players stay in it.
But Britain never wanted to be in it anyway.
They didn't make their money the same.
Yeah, they don't. I mean, they never went over to the pound. I mean, the euro. Britain has always tried to do it with British characteristics. Well,
Britain has never even claimed to be part of Europe. Yeah.
They don't see themselves as the continent.
Yeah. They are different.
We're different. And that's kind of my thought about America sometimes. America is different. And that's why American capitalism does not transport into Europe's system. And Europe's system can't transport America because our systems have developed so differently.
But do you think that as we change, because we're going to change, that'll break us, or do you think we'll pull this off?
But think about it. If you can, if we as a society struggle with the middle, with the middle group, I think sometimes when you hear people talk, they forget. Our American system of government is a compromise document. The great compromise is the Constitution. There's nothing but, think about it, the Missouri Compromise, the 1850 compromise is typically when America does not compromise that they are in trouble. As in the Civil War, we couldn't compromise any longer. We got a war. So
you think we're not working together well
enough? So when the systems don't compromise because of how we're set up, our system won't work.
Well, I think people are going to look back someday and say, this past eight plus years.
How do a two-party system, when one controls one branch and the other controls the other, how can they not compromise?
But we haven't for 8 years.
I understand that. But the idea is then, how are you not compromising if one has one and one has the other when the system say you got to work?
That's where it becomes our responsibility, and hence this.
But the idea of, I don't have to deal with people who don't see things my way.
Is transferring into politics now?
Well, at least that's what, when I was reading it, that's.
But that means that you're setting up the United States for a possible altercation between these two groups.
I don't know if it said altercation, but it was just interesting.
Oh, you're still going off that article.
The article was, I mean, but you can see it in even where we at here. Our kids, let's be honest, they struggle with the middle. They struggle. So while they're good with each other, when you were talking about, man, you got to take ownership of your school.
That was like a mind, like.
Really? Why?
Well, no, some of them got it, but yes, others were like.
I'm going to be out of here in another week.
Yeah, one kid said, I got 8 weeks left. I don't give a crap about this school. Mm-hmm. And you're just like, oh, I have no answer.
But see, that's the middle.
I have no
answer. Because that's the middle. Because in the past, you'd be like, hey, this is my school. You know,
well, you would also, I would live in the neighborhood with the kids, and I would drive to said student's mom and just be like, Mrs. Johnson,
knew the neighbors.
What's going on?
You know, you knew the neighbors, yeah, right? Mm-hmm.
It's interesting. But just like the internet, you can hide behind your personality on the internet.
Yeah.
Which gives people lots more bravery on what they say.
Sure.
And maybe school is getting like that.
That's true.
Students are a little more brave. So send me home for 10 days. That's fine. I'll catch up my work, mm-hmm. Which is crazy. If you can catch up your work after being absent for 10 days, maybe school's too convenient.
I never forget. Miss Frazier told this to Miss Heilig one time.
Up goes Frazier.
And Frazier, the student had missed a lot of days. And Miss Heilig had passed.
Oh, so this is pretty recent, within the last year, because it's been a year. Rest in peace, Miss Heilig. Oh, I thought you said after she had passed.
No. I said she had passed the student, missed some days, a lot of days. And Frazier called her down and and I remember Frazier did that to me too, and I didn't fight with him. I'm like, okay, yes, ma'am. She said, if the student missed that many days, and she passed, why do we need you?
Completely agree.
Why do we need
you? You didn't. There was no accountability.
They passed. You know, sometimes we just pass students to get them on. But she's like, why do we need you? And that's my point.
Editing that out.
You know what I mean? You think about it. Why? Then if you're missing. And it makes sense.
Glad that our average watch time ended an hour ago. One got near that comment.
If you got 10 days, if you literally got 10 days, how are you walking away with a B or an A?
All right. And there.
Then it's no need.
Happened. I don't want to get too into.
You know what
this.
I mean? Why does the school need you?
Be ready. I had a student who missed, out of the 9 weeks, which is 45 days, mm-hmm. missed 30. And when you pulled up their EDSB,
it'll show you their grades.
It'll show their grades in every other class.
Report card.
One teacher had 100%.
Mm-hmm. So why, now think on this. If that's the case, A, why do I need to come to school?
What are they doing?
Well, as a student, why do I need to come to school? I still got an A. And B, why do I need to do anything for you?
Oh, yeah, it bleeds over.
It bleeds over.
Why are you asking me to do work?
Like, so-and-so missed 40 days, and they still got an A. So even when they come to school, they're not going to do any work. So as a parent, why would I send my kid to school?
Well, I think we, in the next 20 years, we already discussed that there's going to be a movement away from public school.
Yeah, there'll be a movement.
Which is bad, because let's talk about this. You and I both know who's going to be in these schools.
Well, I understand.
Poor kids.
Maybe.
What do you mean maybe? That's terrible.
Maybe.
It's like a white flight of the school systems.
Maybe.
We're going to be leaving people behind.
Are they and being left behind right now?
I'm completely with you on this. So, but yet
we're in
the worse. Worse.
I don't think so.
Think of a regular class 10 years ago, and think of a regular class today.
But that's because they eliminated and just moved people up. 15 years ago, 20 years ago, when you was in
Kevlar,
when you were 20 years ago, when you was in school or whatever, that was basic too, right?
Yeah.
That was basic.
But
they don't have.
If you had any self-respect, you wouldn't have been in it.
I knew a lot of people who was in basic classes. Took basic U.S. history, basic math.
Oh, I probably had basic math, for sure.
You know.
I wasn't great at math.
I just think we, when we have...
We either need to change or we're screwed.
When we have Bashum, we need to put the question, honestly and truthfully, in a globalized world, where does a high school really fit in, and is the high school really getting them ready? Because if you put them out there and they're vulnerable because they don't have a profession that is kind of protective of globalization. You're going to see more and more people like in your video in Greece. We feel threatened. Stop the immigrant. Or not stop the immigrant. We can't have all these people who are fleeing other parts of the world.
And we become
we can't have them here. We can't be a safe haven.
Because our social system can't support.
Because it can't support them, and it doesn't, and it won't support us.
And this is why Europe is freaking out.
Teetering.
Oh, you'll even go as far as to say teetering, huh?
Teetering. It's
wow.
Teetering.
That's a strong
Your girl, Angela Merkel.
Angela.
Yeah, huh.
Angela.
Yeah, huh.
Yes, her.
Just a year ago.
One of the most powerful women in the world.
Just a year ago, she was, powerful woman.
Extremely.
Now her party is in trouble in Germany right now.
Yeah, they are.
They're in trouble. And why?
Because the extreme groups on the left and the right.
And she was like, no, we're going to bring them here.
Well, yeah, she said 500,000.
Yeah.
That's an insane amount of people.
And
to
they
help
were
support.
Like, no, we don't want them. And now her party is.
Yeah, but I want you to imagine being Germany. It's been 75 years since you
Europe
made a mistake.
Europe as a whole
hasn't
had to deal with this.
But Germany. The last time you made a mistake.
You was on the wrong side of history.
It was over immigration.
And you was on the wrong side of history.
I can completely understand where she was coming from, which is, this is Germany. We have changed.
We don't want to be on
and
the wrong side of history again.
Unfortunately, by making this comment, she's shown that there are still a lot of people in Germany
that has not changed.
That have not changed.
Especially, I bet good money.
Oh my God!
And I was.
No, suspect, don't drop a name.
No.
Oh, okay.
And I would suspect it's from the eastern part of Germany.
Oh well, the Russian conquered Soviet part for so long.
Because they've been trying to integrate them. Remember, the West was much.
Well, look at Poland. Poland has an extreme right wing movement. Ukraine has an extreme right-wing movement. Yeah, Sweden has an extreme.
Every one of them has it. France.
The only reason there's no super extreme left-wing movements is because communism has seemingly failed. Seemingly.
France has one.
So there's
the National Front.
Marie Le Pen and his daughter. Yeah.
They've been battling back and forth.
And his daughter's in power.
In power.
Even after making
terrible
comments.
And he's suing her. He's suing her.
He's suing his daughter?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, he's suing his daughter.
Marie Le Pen.
Because
National Front.
She's more liberal than him.
Wow.
Yeah.
I thought it was the opposite.
No, she's
I thought she said, I'm getting rid of you because you're a wuss.
But he's even further out. she got rid of him because, like, you ain't finna take our country. You ain't gonna take the party that far.
Oh, wow.
And he's suing her. Yeah. They're like, how dare she throw me out of the party?
Well, I know Poland is moving quickly to the right.
I think all of them are.
Because Greece, we know. Greece has Nazis, guys. 10% of the Greek population voted for Golden Dawn.
They're all struck by this immigration thing.
And it's weird. I don't want to sit at this table and say that I wouldn't feel...
The only one that doesn't have this issue is Britain, because Britain is an island.
Yeah, you can't get to it.
You can't get to it.
And you're not allowed to walk over the channel.
No.
Under the channel. Through.
Through the channel.
It's not walkable.
No. So Britain can be spared compared to the others.
And Britain is fleeing the connection to Europe. Which means, very soon, that if you get on the channel, you will need a passport.
Mm-hmm. I had to have one when I got on it.
Even being part of the Euro?
Mm-hmm.
Or the European Union, mm-hmm. We should say, not the Euro.
I had to show my passport.
They had to show your passport? Mm-hmm. That's weird, because the rule of being in the European Union is you didn't have to show your passport.
Yeah, when I went from Britain to Brussels, I had to show my passport.
Usually you ask them to stamp it just because you're a tourist. No, give me a stamp of Great Britain.
No, everybody had to.
Oh.
And then when I went from Brussels back to London, I had to show it again.
Huh. So maybe England's already doing the...
That was last year.
Yeah. Thank you. Last year. I travel, Boyko. I have a wife who makes a lot of money.
I told my kids, I said, as we wrap up this show, I told my kids, why send a child to college? My wife did not go to college. And she's doing great. So the argument is, you got to go to college to make it. No, you don't.
Not anymore.
You just need a skill and some certificates showing you have the ability to do something.
And have learned how to learn.
Learn how to learn. That's right.
That's it. Just learn how to learn.
Learn how to hustle.
Hustle you can learn later.
You learn how to, but that's what I mean. You got to learn how to learn and hustle.
If I want this job.
This is what you got to do to make things happen. And if you can... I told them, I said, the company will take care of you because they
see
you as...
they'll do it.
They'll do it.
This is why the new mission statement of Hillsborough County is so short but powerful. We're preparing students for life.
Really?
What the heck?
You know what I put down with our mission statement?
We could have ended this, this show perfectly.
You know what I put down with our new mission statement should be here at Jefferson?
What?
Preparing for graduation.
It is late in the year, folks. We're getting a little teacheritis, which
is preparing for graduation.
Forced upon us by senioritis because we did this show last year. Last year, half the seniors weren't graduating.
And this is the worst number.
So it's worse this year. We're trying to really get these seniors.
That's why maybe our mission should be preparing them for graduation.
But our boy Omar's doing so good that he got contacted by the Tampa Tribune. Right? He might have a chance at $1,200.
Well, that's good. That's good.
Scholarships and stuff. So, 99-1.
Yeah. But throwback it's in the wrong direction.
Mr. Quinn.
It's in the wrong direction.
99-1.
Yeah.
We need to focus. It's probably
1-99.
It's probably 54-46 right now.
How about 1-99?
All right, Omar. Take us out. We could have ended so well.
We did.
And then you have to...
We did it well.